Hey, and welcome back to the Magic Animal Club podcast with me, Squidoodley.
And me, Stampy. I always hate those. Those intros just feel really like game showy. You know, like, it's like, hey, it's me, Bubbler, and, you know, your special guest. And then they come out and say their own name. It's like when, like, most comedians introduce themselves. Mm-hmm, like, yeah. Before they go on stage, like, if you listen, it always seems weird. It's like, please welcome to the stage, you know, Billy the comedian. And he goes, hi, I'm Billy. You know? But they always do it like a slightly different voice, so you can't. You don't really notice unless you're really listening out to it.
I always thought it was because they were trying to save some money and they didn't want to employ just like an announcement guy to come along. You know, I thought it was
something like that. That would be all they would do, wouldn't it? Like that would just be their job.
Their one and only job.
Just record it. Just get someone with a good voice to record. I think it's quite nice though, them introducing themselves. Anyway, let's not immediately just dive into some bizarre random topic. Let's kind of discuss last week's podcast a bit. So you were away last week, weren't you?
Yeah, I was away. I was on holiday for a week long. Me and Stamps recorded one podcast before we left. And we kind of had a discussion to split the other podcast to cover while I was getting back from holiday, because we didn't want it to be kind of like the same sort of thing, because we literally just spoke for an hour and a bit, so it would have been the same sort of topic. So yeah, we did it a little different. I did the first half, which was kind of like the first half an hour, and then Stamps did his half a little different to me. You did a live stream, didn't you, Stamps?
Yeah, I did the first ever live Magic Animal Club podcast. And I think a lot of people generally get confused. A lot of people, I think, assumed the whole podcast was live. Like, normally it's not live. Like, that was only done for last week. Kind of as a bit of an experiment, but also because we didn't have much of a choice, seeing as, like, we weren't together anyway. So, like, no matter what, the podcast would have been separated. And I just kind of, I thought that, well, rather than trying to speak by myself, I might as well just speak to the audience. And, well, okay, if I speak about my first then, it was difficult. I found it really stressful because...
Stressful?
It was me... Well, yeah, because it was me talking. And then... So I tried doing the podcast. I did it live, but I didn't announce really beforehand when I was going to do it. And I tried doing it quite early in the day, thinking that most people kind of wouldn't be around. And that might sound weird to purposely have less people listening, but I thought that if there's too many people listening, then it's kind of harder to get a conversation and it might just kind of be like a wall of text. And it turned out that that's what happened anyway. So there was, I think it said it was at peak, it was like averaging about 800 comments a minute or something.
Oh.
And it was just literally whizzing by. And so I was so, and it was lots of, and it wasn't a conversation. It was lots of people just writing one word things or, you know, just saying cress and, so it was amusing to read, but of course everyone else listening couldn't read that, and so every now and then I'd just giggle because people would be saying things. So the problem was I was by myself. If I was with you, they could have one person talking while the other person's reading.
Yeah.
But the fact I was trying to read comments and I was the only voice, it was really difficult. And I don't know how it kind of turned out. It's kind of hard to judge when I listen to it myself, but it was a challenge to do.
Yeah, I mean, I can imagine, you know, like, when you're on a live stream, you're so kind of focused on what's going on in the chat. I mean, that's one of the reasons why I didn't want to do it, because I kind of had an idea of what I wanted to talk about in my sort of half, but I also could rely on the basically, like, the Twitter. And obviously, Twitter's just, you know, stationary unless you scroll up or scroll down, so you can kind of focus on what's going on. And I reckon if I would have done the live stream, it just would have been, like, a big sort of mess, because I get distracted so easily. So I might be on one topic and then I could have like looked at the chat and then I would have been on a completely different random topic. And yeah, I don't know how you did it. But like, yeah, you said, maybe we should have a week trying it together and seeing how that sort of pans out. That might have kind of worked. But I think
that would work perfectly. I think having one, like, so basically we take turns speaking and take turns reading the chat. And I mean, I think maybe like, we just do the podcast as normal. Like, I don't want it to just be us only reading comments. I think chat is normal, but every now and then just kind of see what other people think about the topic, or, you know, we can do a live Squiddy Tips, you know, as someone suggests it live, you know. I think that might be fun. My worry is, though, is I don't want to kind of alienate the people that aren't listening live, because always the majority of people won't be listening live, and I don't want them to feel like they're missing out because they weren't there. You know, people just have different schedules. People are busy. They might not be able to listen as we're doing it live. And that's kind of my worry.
Yeah, you don't really want to turn it into a scheduled live stream that goes out on a podcast rather than a podcast that sometime might go out on a live stream. You don't want it to be like, the opposite way around type of thing. So, yeah, but we could try it.
We're experimenting. So we got a mixed reception. So some people just like, it's just not the same. It's rubbish. You know, if you're not talking to each other, I don't like it. A lot of other people said that it's actually quite nice. You know, so some people kind of enjoyed the interaction and just kind of enjoyed us speaking separately. And there was one comment. And I don't know if you saw this because I tweeted So let me just read this comment. And so it's from Harry. And the thing is, a lot of people started saying like, oh, ignore the haters. Like, he wasn't hate. Like, it was just a funny comment. I wasn't having to go at this person because, I appreciate that they listen, and they ultimately ended up saying they enjoyed it. But it was just the quickest turnaround from hating something to loving it. So this comment said, this is in caps as well. Lots of exclamation marks. I hate this. Never do it again. It's awful and boring. I like unique conversation. This is just boring. And you're rambling on. No disrespect to you guys. You are amazing, but I found this quite boring. Maybe I was overacting before, but I don't like it, and I don't think anyone else does. Please don't do it again. And then another comment 3 minutes later saying, actually, this is all right. And then another minute later, another comment saying, in fact, it's awesome. Still not as good as normal, though. It's just the quickest turnaround from like, I hate it. It's awful. Never want it again. Actually, it's okay. Actually, I love it. Best thing ever.
Yeah. It's like they were typing as they were listening. Like, normally what happens is they listen to the whole thing and then they write up a summary and a comment. But that guy couldn't wait. He was like, I'm going to comment every single minute of every single thing
that happens.
It was
like a live review. It's like reviewing a film or a game as you play it.
Oh, man. That's pretty amazing.
But overall, I think people, the plan never was. I think people were worried that I was like, right, we're changing the format of the podcast. That wasn't the case. It was just because Squid was away. Yeah, we kind of just did something different. Speaking of Squid being away, where did you go and how was it?
Well, I kind of touched upon it in the last podcast. It was really good. It was a really good little holiday break. The weather was amazing. The only thing that kind of let it down
you're in the south of England, Squid. You're living like a king down here. Sunshine all year. It's like Los Angeles. It's like Britain's Los Angeles down here. It's amazing. But it never rains.
I've got such a tan stamp. You wouldn't believe it. I've actually got like a really good tan. Pretty happy about that. It was really good. I managed to get all my videos kind of done before I went away. I did mention it. But the only thing that let it down was there was no signal or reception where we were staying at. So, I was kind of good because I had everything, planned out. For once, I had everything planned out and all I had to do was kind of upload it from like TeamViewer. I kind of explained what it was in the last podcast, but I couldn't do it in the house because there was no like decent Wi-Fi, there's no connection or anything like that. So I actually got signal when we went out for a walk with the dogs and I was literally in the middle of the woods on my phone, like uploading and making a thumbnail on my phone from home. But all in all, it was a really good holiday. I enjoyed it a lot. So, yeah, good time.
Glad to hear it. What's it like coming back, though? I know we talked about this a little bit when I got back from Italy, but it's always kind of a weird thing to return from that because in some way it's nice to go back to making videos, but you're inevitably behind on making videos, so it's kind of stressful getting caught back up. So how's that been?
When I was driving to the holiday, I was so happy because everything was done. And I had like my throat was on the recovery because I'd been recording so many videos. I think I did like 20 videos in like a week or something. I was doing a lot. So like just when you're down there, you don't have like any worries. It's kind of like, oh, I could just relax for a week. I don't have to kind of worry if this video is going to be going live, which ultimately I did have to worry about because nothing really worked down there. But yeah, no, I've kind of enjoyed getting back into it. There's a lot to do because I believe you're going away again. If this isn't that right? I think you're going away.
Yeah, I'm away. I don't know the exact date I'm going away, but I'm away again soon for about a week. Yeah, so we're going to have to do it all over again. But that's something that we have to deal with, no one else. So, the thing is, no matter what, like we're pretty good at keeping videos ticking by as normal. No matter the situation, it generally doesn't affect the people viewing. It's just us getting stressed out and worrying about it the whole time.
I think it's fun though because like if you do a lot of series like on your own, it's a lot of pressure just on you. But like before I went away, I needed to do like three time travelers, and without like stamps and Ash, like I would never be able to do it. Like the way my voice was in, like by the last episode, my voice was in pieces. It was breaking through the intro. and like it was just a nightmare. But since you can do other videos with other people, it helps out a lot. And you know,
But the thing is, though, what a lot of people don't realize is they might look at, okay, let's look at Squid's channel, and they say, right, okay, so he does a Minecraft video every day, and then he, you know, he does, you know, the stuff on his second channel and things, and they'll look at what you do. But what you they don't really see is how much you're doing on other people's channels. You know, same with me. So, you know, I have all the series on my channel, but then I also do Island of Eden, I also do Time Travelers, I also do Super Happy Fun Times with Squashy as well. So that's like an extra three whole series that I do, which, you know, kind of take just as much effort, you know, but it's just not on my channel. And I think kind of a lot of people kind of forget that, you know, that you're kind of doing all of this kind of extra stuff as well for other people's channels. You know, and it goes both ways. It's not like I'm complaining, you know, other people join me on my channel as well. But it's just like, it's a lot more than just the series on our own channels that we have to worry about.
Yeah, like when you're saying yes to a series, it's not just that. You know, it's not just, yeah, I can fit it in, but it's that worry of, you know, it's just another lot of videos you've got to kind of take time out. Because I wouldn't say it's really the timing. I'd say for our jobs, it's quite a lot of keeping your voice intact, because if you do too much and you kind of lose your voice, then it's a massive, you know, it's a massive downfall on you, you know, your productivity and getting everything else done, so... Yeah.
And just energy and motivation. Like, if you're not in the mood to do a video, if you're going, oh, I just don't, you know, I'm just tired, I got a bit of a cold, I just don't fancy recording today, you're going to make a rubbish video. You know, you can't fake that. And so you've got to kind of keep up motivation to keep wanting to record as well.
Yeah.
Oh, it's so difficult, Squid. It's so tough. It's so,
I'm going to go work in Tesco's again.
My little voice.
I'm off to work in Tesco's to see you later.
That's what it sounds like. We're not moaning. We're just explaining
in
that it's not
every
quite
single
as easy
job,
as people might
think. There is always something to moan about, to be honest with you. And whatever you do, you're always going to... Even if you got the dream job, there's always going to be something that you're going to moan about. So...
It's just natural.
It's natural.
Just moaning, especially if you're British. Moaning is just... It's what you're taught when you're born.
Yeah.
You're taught to speak, then you're taught to moan.
Have a good
you're
moan.
First thing you do is you moan because you don't know enough other words. You just... and to tut.
Oh, yeah. We do a lot of tutting. I wonder if there's... Did the Americans, like, moan about stuff as much as British people do?
Like, I think let me just generalize an entire race of people. I think most Americans moan about things that are probably, in general, worth moaning about more. I don't think that... I think moaning's a more negative thing for Americans, whereas it's like... We love it when something goes wrong to moan. Like, in England, yeah, if someone drops a glass somewhere and
everyone
it smashes,
goes,
everyone
hey!
Cheers. You know? People love desire. People love it when things fail, and they're kind of rooting for that, because it's like... It's a bit of fun for us. And I think that there is some extent of that in America, but not in the same way.
Yeah, do they do that anywhere else in the world? Like, if you're like a restaurant or a pub or anything like that, and if someone smashes a glass on the floor, even if it's someone that works there, does anyone else just have the urge to go, hey!
I'm sure they must do, but it's just such a...
Oh, but
you know,
it's just
a
British
it's just
thing.
Everyone's reaction,
Can we have a section of just British... things that we do in public that's funny? Because, like, I don't know if people even knew about that. I know obviously people that live in Britain do, but what else is there, like, that we kind of pick on?
Well, so something that I really noticed this weekend is just, like, the service, like, customer service in you know, in the UK is shocking. Literally shocking, okay? Especially compared to the US, where it's, you know, amazing. And a big reason for that is kind of tip culture. You know, generally tipping isn't as big a thing here. So you could say a lot of it's falseness, but I don't think it all is. I think that does have something to do with it. But I think it's generally a lot of Americans, like stranger Americans or Americans that are working, are just friendlier, naturally friendlier. And so I had an experience this weekend, I genuinely couldn't believe. So this weekend I went to the zoo. Okay.
Which zoo?
And... is a Marwell Zoo.
Marwell Zoo. I don't think I've ever heard.
Not too far from where from where we are. And it was amazing. I got to see giraffes, which are my favorite animals. There were penguins, and there was like a million of them, and you were right next to them. They were adorable. There was, you know, lots of lemurs around. So it was a really good, the zoo's great. Okay, so I'm not saying anything. The zoo was lovely. The animals, you know, they were great. I didn't see the lions weren't there. No, I didn't know why. Yeah, so the animals, I have nothing wrong with the animals. The people at Marwell Zoo, though, they were generally, so some of them were friendly, but there was one particular instance which was absolutely unbelievable. So it was me and Squishy there, and we wanted to get an ice cream. Okay, and there was a bit of a queue to go and get this ice cream, but it was like fresh from, like, straight from the farm, really good looking ice cream. Straight from the cow, and it looked like good ice cream, and we're like, right, we're going to queue up and get this ice cream. We realized that the reason it was such a long queue is because it was like the two slowest people in the world working there. They just didn't care. You could just tell they didn't want to be there. There was zero eye contact. They were just grumbling, just chatting to each other, and we were queuing for ages. Eventually, we got to the front, and then this guy's like, right, what do you want? And I was like, okay, I want 2 mint choc chips in cones with flakes. And he was, yeah, all right. And he went to start doing it, and then someone else came in. He was like, oh, you're needed at the barbecue. And he went, oh, right, good. It's awful in here. He just walked off, didn't even look or say anything to us. The guy, and then, so he just left. And the other guy's there. He starts serving someone else. And then eventually that new guy who came in, who had no idea what he was doing, went to us and said, oh, yeah, what do you want? I was like, okay, all right, we'll order again. I was like, 2 mint choc chip ice creams with cones and flakes. And he was like, yeah, all right. And then the other guy started telling. So then the other guy went to him and said, oh, no, you got to write down everything that people order on this paper. Then they had this whole chit chat. And then he went and started just writing down stuff in the paper and just ignored us. And then the other guy who was there started serving someone else. Eventually he, the third person, the one we hadn't spoke to yet, said, right, what do you want? I was like, well, we've already ordered twice before, but I want a mint chick chop chippity ice cream and a cone and 2 flakes. Okay. He then told the other guy to make them, and he made them. He forgot the flakes, but charged us for them. So we're like, oh, we asked for flakes as well. He just grabbed them with his hands and just passed us 2 flakes that we just held. And like, oh, I could, and it was like, I think it was something like £4.20 or something for 2 ice cream, the smallest scoop. And it was just the worst. They just couldn't have cared less. And we just couldn't believe it.
Did you complain? It was
like, no, because what? Why? Who cares? You know, they don't want to be, you know, they're not looking for the career in the ice cream zoo industry, are they? You know, they're obviously just whatever, you know, a bit of money for the weekend. You know, like, they were just, it's hard to explain just how just rude and rubbish these two people were.
That's crazy.
And then, this isn't a complaint. This is just funny. So because we're in the queue for a while, and it was like the bank holiday weekend, so there was a lot of kids around. So while we were queuing, a little crowd had formed that had spotted Squishy and me. And so then when after we did it, they asked for some pictures. And then once some people saw that we were kind of having pictures and who we were, you know, we had like a little kind of mini meet and greet. And so while I was doing that, Squishy was holding my ice cream, and then almost my ice cream melted.
Oh, no.
It was fine. I'm not moaning about that. Like, everyone we met was really nice. Actually, another funny moment with that. Sorry, I know I'm talking a lot here, but it was a fun day at the zoo. We were waiting, so there was a little like kind of tiny train, so like a real train, but like mini, that just goes around the zoo, so you can kind of see everything there. Yeah. And there's just basically crossings all over the zoo where the train goes past. And we were waiting at the crossing, and like they obviously tell everyone to wave because like the train driver was waving, and then there was like a whole bunch of people in the train just waving, and so we were just waving back to everyone. And then there was these 2 girls at the back, and that just as they went past, they were kind of getting a little bit further away, but they just suddenly realized it was me, and they just shouted like, Stampy! And I went, hello! And just like waved to them. And then they both screamed. One of them flung her arm up, and she had a bag of marshmallows and just dropped them everywhere. And then they were like jumping up. You could tell they just wanted to jump off the train, but you know, they couldn't. It was a moving train. And then because the train just zigzagged all over the park, we just kept seeing them just zooming past every now and then. Go, Stampy! Just see them waving. We're like, hello! And eventually we did like meet up with them in the gift shop, so we did get a picture of them and stuff, because I think they would have been upset otherwise. But that was a funny moment.
Oh, man. Did you have any parents like say, you know, who are these guys? Like the kids. Did you have that awkward thing where the kids have to explain what you do and then the parents judge you? Did you have that?
No, I think most of the kids, most of the parents knew.
Okay.
There was one girl and their mum who were kind of basically having an argument whether it is me or not. And I could see the kids saying, like, it's him. And the mum go, no, it's not, he wouldn't be here. You know, so I did see that, but that was kind of the only thing like that. But a lot of the parents are friends. I mean, you can see that the parents are kind of very, you know, they're thinking, right, you know, they've come to the zoo together, you know, they kind of, you know, give them some space a bit. A lot of the parents were kind of saying that, you know, because I think a lot of the kids were like, come around the zoo with us, you know, we end up just a giant group going around the zoo. So a lot of the parents were kind of sort of holding back their kids a bit, like, all right, let them go now. But no, it was great. It was really fun. I don't know, we went there not really expecting that, but then we suddenly thought, oh yeah, it's bank holiday weekend, there's gonna be a lot of people around. So yeah, if anyone is listening to this who we met at Marwell Zoo, nice to meet you.
Hello. Again.
Hello again.
That's good,
so what have you? I know. Obviously, you've been away. Is there any stories that happened while you were away?
Not really. I mean, it's all been pretty straightforward and dandy, to be honest. It's been one of them just very smooth holidays. So, well, it wasn't very smooth. I don't want to kind of put like a bad turn on the podcast, but one of Nicole's great grandmas passed away while we were there. So, like, her grandma and granddad had to, like, leave, like, really early, which was kind of a bummer. So, we got, like, the funeral tomorrow to go to. So, that was kind of a bummer. Not to put, like, a downer on the podcast, but, I mean, that happened. The only thing that was, like, kind of annoying about the holiday is that the roads were, like, stupidly tight. And I mean, like, stupid. Like, you could barely just fit, like, a car, like, down these roads. So if you met anyone, you had to, like, reverse, like, literally a mile to kind of move out of the way. There was just these big, giant hedges at either side, and you couldn't really go anywhere. So that was fun. But, yeah, nothing really generally happened, Stamps, to be honest. I'm sorry to disappoint you, mate. Being kind of an uneventful holiday.
We had a good time. That's what matters. But sometimes the uneventful ones are the best because you're trying to get away from things, you know?
Yeah.
Even though it's kind of, it's good to get this, like, a lot of stories come out of holidays where, like, oh, remember the time where the uncle fell into the jellyfish pond? You know, you kind of get a lot of these funny stories that you tell for years, but sometimes it's nice just to, like, yeah, we just chilled out. It was nice. Everyone got along.
It was
no drama.
Holiday. We went to the zoo. We went to Longleat. Which is a safari zoo, which is really good. It's probably one of the best ones I've been to. So you go in your car, you can go past like the lions and the tigers, and they have wolves there as well, which is pretty awesome. So in the back, there was my brother and Nicole's two brothers, and there was me and Nicole in the front because we were in our Defender. So we went around once, everything was fine. Nicole wanted to feed the deer, so we bought like this kind of food. This deer stuck its head like inside my Defender, and you're supposed to pour the food out on your hand and hold it flat outside of the vehicle, so obviously it can lick your hand and it can eat and stuff like that. But this deer was so insistent of eating it inside of my car, so she'd hold her hand out, she couldn't get her hand past this deer. It was licking food all over the car. There was food everywhere on the passenger seat. It was an absolute mess. I was like, hold your hand out. She's like, I can't get it past. So the Defender was covered in deer food by the end of this little trip, which was pretty funny. Then we went round again because we had a bit of lunch. We got back in the car. We went round again. And this woman, we pulled up to the little booth where you have to basically drive past again because it goes back around in a circle. And she was like, hi. We showed her the ticket. She was like, oh, have you got any animals in the back of there? So I said no. And then Tom goes, like this. And then all, like, Nicole's brothers started, like, woofing. This woman's looking at me like I'm an idiot because she's asking if we've got any dogs in the back. So I'll just drive away. I'm like, sorry about that. They're a bit immature. But, like, all the way around, it was like, it's quite embarrassing about that. That was quite an embarrassing moment there.
Look at us going to all the zoos.
But apart from that, there was this stupid grandma driver that was in front of us. She was like with a friend. We named her Doris, and she was like, so you have two lanes at Safari. I don't know if you've ever been to one before.
No, I haven't.
No, so there's two lanes. Okay, the left one is for stopping and looking. The right one is for basically overtaking people. But we were stuck behind this grandma who was in the overtaking lane, and she kept swerving into the left lane, but she wouldn't completely move over. So she was like in half of each lane and we was trying to get past her and she just would not move. So it got to the point where I was literally beeping her, telling her to move out of the way because we wanted to get past. But she wouldn't. She was such a stubborn old woman. She wouldn't move out of these two lanes and she was blocking the whole zoo. Just not happy.
Outrageous. Welcome to the podcast where Squid and I moan about our zoo experience.
I just didn't know what she was doing. Like, I don't know if there was like comparing like knitting needles and different knitting techniques.
I think she was trying to sell ice cream. That's what it was. Yeah. She's trying to get a crowd together to sell some ice cream.
Just so annoying. Just literally £2.10
for a small scoop.
It sounds like we've been to like a lot of zoos. Sounds pretty good.
Well, what do you think? So a lot of people, I think even more recently, like, I think zoos have kind of been starting to get more controversial. Because I know you're, like, a big animal lover,
yeah.
You know, probably even more so than me. And, of course, you know, it's a bunch of animals kind of out of their, you know, in captivity, out of their environment. So what do you think about zoos?
Well, I mean, there's some zoos that I kind of don't really tend to go to. And there's some kind of zoos that I do. So yeah, I mean, let me
just
explain.
Like,
okay,
zoos as a concept.
Zoos,
what do you think?
It depends where they've come from, and it depends what their enclosures are like. I love safaris because they have, you know, like I don't know, quite a lot of acres to kind of roam in. The zoos have spent, or the safaris have spent quite a lot of money on their environment to kind of mimic or give them a good life in their sort of environment. But some zoos, they're really cheap. They buy these animals, they have the license, and the animals are, you can tell, they're not kept well, they're skinny, and it's pretty much cruel. It's very cruel to see the animal in that kind of way. There is a place near us, which I absolutely love, and it's called Yorkshire Wildlife Park, and it is a wildlife park, so they have loads of animals. It's about 200 acres or something stupid like that, so these animals have so much room, probably not as much room as they have in the wild, but you know, it's a lot of room to have, and I absolutely love it. So there's two kind of zoos, you know, there's zoos that can obviously don't treat the animals well, and then there's some that do. So yeah, that's kind of where I stand on them.
I think that zoos generally are okay now. Like, obviously, it depends how well the animals are kept, but mm-hmm. because so much of them are about conservation and, you know, they raise money and, you know, they're kind of looking after animals. Like, I feel like, in general, even if, like, it might sound a bit heartless, but I think kind of for the greater good, if there's one, you know, one group of animals which isn't living in the wild, but it helps thousands of animals across the country, you know, I think that generally is kind of worth it.
Yeah.
But when we got there, and there was a few in particular where I saw like a monkey, and I was like, it's living its whole life in that kind of little area it's swinging around in. And I'm sure it was fine. But, and also there's like the, so we've been watching, well, we've finished watching, there's a show called Meerkat Manor. It was on TV ages ago. So it's basically, it's kind of like a reality show for meerkats.
Yeah.
So it's basically a documentary, but you kind of, they give them all names and you kind of know their personality. And so we watched a lot of this. And so we know a lot about meerkats. And we know that they, like, you know, travel miles every day. And we see that, like, every day they travel to a new area to get new food and stuff. And so we knew a lot about them. And then when we saw basically their enclosure, which was basically about the, you know, slight, not that much bigger than like our living room, but it has an underground area and they're all kind of packed in and they can't roam. I did feel like, well, that's not what they're supposed to do. How are they going to, you know, how are they going to get around? So, you know, there are specific times where I was like, oh man, that kind of, that sucks for them. You know, I feel sorry for them and the penguins as well, you know, but, you know, if having people pay to see them and that money goes towards people and spreading awareness, you know, that might be saving a whole, you know, a thousand meerkats in the wild. Like, is it worth it? Like, it's kind of hard. In a way, you see, yeah, for the greater good, it is worth it. But then in another sense, you can say, why is it kind of up to us to choose? You know, like, the animals should be able to do what they want. You know, why do we choose? These are the ones that have to live in captivity. So it's kind of, it is a bit of a weird subject.
It is a weird subject, but again, as you said, there is some zoos that do it right, and, you know, I think what needs to be done is actually just kind of bringing attention to what is a good zoo, what do the animals need, what's kind of a bad zoo, because you get kind of parents taking kids to zoos, and they're like, oh, look at the little monkeys, oh, they're so cute, and then they kind of, like, the kids get brought up thinking that the enclosure that the monkey's in is fine, but it's not. Like, and I think it's kind of the parents that need educating more than, you know, the kids, to be honest with you. But yeah, as I said, zoos, generally, they do kind of good. They do kind of good. But there was one thing in the news, actually, that I kind of want to bring up since we're on the topic of zoos, which is absolutely mind-blowing. So it was a silverback gorilla in, I believe it was Cincinnati, and this little kid basically went underneath the railings, and it jumped down like a 20-foot enclosure, landed in like a moat that the silverback gorilla was in. The gorilla then kind of took the kid around, and, you know, because obviously, you know, gorilla doesn't know what to do. They're kind of aggressive with any sort of human and stuff like that. But it wasn't aggressive. It was just kind of, you know, taking it around its enclosure, dragging it around and stuff like that. The guys who obviously work at the zoo, look after the animals and stuff like that, they then shot this silverback gorilla dead. They didn't tranquilize it. They just shot it straight up dead. And this was an endangered animal. And yet the animal is to blame. Like, the animal did nothing. The gorilla gets shot, you know. I just don't...
Like, I don't think it's... So I saw the video as well, and I don't think it's like, oh, the animal's to blame. I think that's just a case where they had to... They had to make a decision, and they had to see, like, and I think that, I mean, the gorilla was pretty aggressive with the boy, and it's not his fault, you know, it's an animal. Yeah. You know, it doesn't know what's going on. So you can't blame the gorilla, but I think at some point you have to say, you know, like, the boy is in a certain amount of danger, and it wasn't immediately, so I think they were trying other options, because the boy was in there for 10 minutes. You know, it's not like they shot the gorilla immediately.
Yeah.
I think it just got to a point where they're like, you know, things, you know, and because the gorilla was kind of dragging it around in the water as well, and I think there was fear of the boy drowning, so I think, you know, it was a difficult decision, and it's kind of... It's just kind of the point, you know, do you rate a child's life, a human life, over a gorilla's? And I think at that point, I think you kind of have to, I guess.
Yeah.
It's just a bad situation. You know, then ultimately the blame, you know, comes down to the parents. You know, the boy's a really young boy as well.
Yeah,
so
it's
think,
just bad
you know,
parenting.
The boy obviously can't be to blame, you know. And so, and they are being prosecuted, the parents as well. So they are kind of... You know, they are the ones in the blame. It's just a rubbish situation. I think that everyone was obviously going to give hate to the zoo, but it's kind of, they had to make a tough decision. You know, what else could they have done? You know, tranquilizers, you know, take a while to kind of kick in and might have angered the gorilla more. So it's kind of, you know, like if the zoo did nothing and the outcome was, you know, different, then, you know, everyone would be blaming the zoo anyway. So it's kind of, I guess the only blame you can do on the zoo is maybe they might need a bigger barrier, but I didn't see how
put
big
a bigger
the barriers
barrier
were.
In.
Yeah, so I mean it did, that was just, you know,
there was something
was
else
situation.
As well, but I don't know if we want to talk about it, but it was just a silly that kind of I read this morning. So silly. Do you want to hear it?
Well, I mean, I'll find out once I've heard it, I guess. It's kind of hard to say, do you want to know?
So
it's
what,
like,
it was,
well, I don't know.
Okay, I'll just talk about it, because it's kind of mind-blowing. I want to hear what you kind of think of it. So it was, I don't know the kind of specifics upon where the location was, but it was kind of either, I think it was in China, and it was this family. There was a mum and a dad, and there was a little boy, and they was in the one of the forests, and they was kind of playing about, and the kid was throwing rocks, and the parents was like, you know, don't do that, it's kind of a bad thing, and the kid carried on doing it. And then, so what they did, the parents then left the boy in this little area near this river in this forest and said, oh, we're gonna leave you here until you've learnt your lesson. And then, so the parents left the kid kind of saying, oh no, we'll go back and get him, we just want to scare him a bit to teach him a lesson because he's been naughty. So they basically, the parents left for like 5 minutes, they came back, the kids basically disappeared in this forest, which is home to like brown bears and stuff like that, and yeah, the kids just wandered off, and now the parents are...
they've not found him.
So, like,
unbelievable.
I'm reading it. I'm like face palming. Like, what kind of a punishment is that? Like, they could have, like, you know, grounded him, but no, they leave him in a forest with brown bears for 5 minutes and thinking that the kid's still going to be there when they get back. It's just...
I mean, it's kind of, it does kind of bring in the question of, should there be some sort of assessment or quiz or test or something that you need to take before you can be a parent? You know, like, should there be...
Can we give them... How many brain cells should people need to have before they can reproduce?
But no, but honestly, because, you know, if you want to drive a car, you take a test to see whether you're good enough to drive the car. You know, and driving the car, you know, it could become quite dangerous. You could danger other people. There's no one compared to being a parent, you know, to have a child's life be your responsibility is a very difficult thing, but there's no, you know, there's no way to assess whether someone is fit to be an parent. And I'm sure that test could exist, but I think that people would just, you know, just object to it, you know, but it might have avoided a situation like that. Who knows?
It's just one of them moments where you just think, you know, like what goes through these people's minds when they're doing stuff like this?
Well, it's just sad because it's always the, you know, the helpless, you know, it's always the child that ends up suffering because of it. You know, it's not like it's always that's, you know, the way it goes. And, you know, and even if, you know, so to say, you know, that didn't happen or the child's found and it's fine, like the damage is kind of just done by the fact that they're bringing up that child. So that child's probably going to end up just like their parents. You know, that's kind of the thing, you know, like that the line doesn't end, you know, like it you know, they keep spreading, you know, their message and stuff. That's kind of the crazy thing.
Just mind-boggling, absolutely mind-boggling.
Anyway, I want to change the topic quite drastically here. So, I don't know if you heard about this, because you were away when it was announced. I mean, you probably have heard of it.
I spoke about it. I know what it is. I know what you're going to say. I read your mind. I know what it is.
Yeah? About the different penguins.
The what?
What?
The penguin, did you say?
Yeah, no, I'm joking. Minecraft. I was playing a joke. Yeah, Minecraft. So I keep calling it battle mode. It's not battle
it's just
mode.
Battle.
It's battle mini game. PvP battle mini game is the catchy title they decided to go with.
I'm super pumped for it. It's going to be good.
Yeah, you're looking forward to it.
Yeah, because...
Go on. I was just going to say what it is. Very quickly. So it's basically survival games, you know, with matchmaking on consoles.
Yeah.
In a nutshell.
But yeah, I'm super pumped for it because I kind of mentioned this in the last one, but it's always been that thing on Xbox where it's a completely different dynamic to PC. You know, there's so much you can do on PC because it's so accurate and the way you can kind of, you know, sort of swing people with your mouse and keyboard and run and jump with the... It's just a lot better sort of system... to kind of play Hunger Games on, but, you know, the kind of like the Minecraft thing on the console is a lot more unique, the way you have to control things, and it always kind of depended on who had the host and you know, stuff like that. But I kind of loved it. I really did love doing Hunger Games on the Xbox, and it's something that I haven't done in ages, just simply because it takes a lot of effort to set up games, and you have to be kind of friends, and if people lag out, you know, in the middle of games, then... You have to kind of have responsibility saying, oh, you know, they might have gone on and won it, and a lot of people get annoyed. And it's just kind of annoying, but I'm hoping, I don't know if Stamps knows, but if they're going to be, like, dedicated servers or not, I hope they are. But yeah, I'm just super happy about it.
On Xbox One and PS4, they run on dedicated servers no matter what. So even if I just invite you to a game that's on a dedicated server, the big question is will that carry across to... you know, the Xbox 360 or the PS3 or the Vita, because this is coming out on the Vita as well, which is kind of pretty amazing if you think about, you know, are they going to dedicate? Because if they don't, if you're playing on Xbox 360 and it doesn't have dedicated servers, then I think that's going to be, depending on the connection, a poor experience, especially if you're playing, you know, 8 players. You know, Xbox 360 can only just about handle 8 players. You know, it's laggy. You know, even if you have a strong connection, it's, you know, it's not generally a good experience. So that's kind of going to be the big question. But it comes out in June, so it's going to come out really soon.
Oh, really?
So we don't have long to wait. And so a lot of people... So I was actually... There was kind of an event where they showed it and announced it and kind of you had a chance to record. We were invited to it, but like it was... I was just coming back from Italy and you were going away. So, yeah, we weren't. So we could have had a chance to play it, but we haven't played it yet. But from what I've seen, it looks good. It's got a proper UI. It's got a grace period built in. Whoa. You know, you kind of have your team colors. And so you can see, because one of the other problems is you wouldn't know if someone's died or not.
No.
There's no real way of knowing unless they back out the game. So that's kind of all being sorted. So it looks like it's got everything you'd expect there. There's a selection of maps. So the way it's working is there's going to be a certain amount of maps which are free and the update itself is free. But then they are going to sell future maps. Uh-huh. And I reckon they're going to be the ones which will be like the Mario map, the Halo map, you know, the Enchanted, you know, they're going to be the themed maps is what my guess is.
Is
I mean, I've not spoke to 4J about it. I don't know.
Do you know any more in terms of Like, is there going to be a chance where creators can build their own maps and submit them, or is it strictly just on just their sort of servers and their maps type of thing?
So, I mean at the moment, it's just theirs. That would make so much sense. And because there's a really easy way to send maps. So basically, if you need to send a map to like 4J or Microsoft or something, basically you can just set it to be uploaded. You know, because you transfer a world from 360 to Xbox One.
Yep.
You can just basically upload a world and then they can just basically download it. So sending maps in would be relatively simple, it sounds like. That would just make a world of sense.
If they had like a system where you could, as a creator, have a certain block that signified a spawn point, and then maybe just... to have a system.
But you can set a spawn point. You can do that. I could do that right now. I'm gonna, for those watching the video podcast, I don't know if anything's come up on your screen, but
yeah,
I've just set the world spawn. So if you die now, you're going to spawn on the top of a big tree.
Okay.
So I mean, that's already in there. And I think that there's other things, obviously, you know, sorting out the chests and stuff, you know, there would be something they'd have to do. But I don't think they'd be doing it en masse.
4J, if you're listening, can I just suggest an idea?
Yes.
Okay. Well,
I represent 4J.
So because Minecraft's got so many, I think they've got, you know, three different sort of chests. They've got the trap chest, the normal chest and the ender chest. They could have them as tiers, and then they could just select a bunch of weapons to each tier, and then when a player kind of creates a map, they could just place the different tiers in different locations that justify the loot that's inside. If that makes sense.
I mean, I think a way to do it is, and unless they're planning to add hundreds of maps, is you upload just the map as it is, and then they set the spawn point and do the chests and stuff. 4J can just do that. I think that might be the easier way to do it.
we could submit our map that we made on the PS3 that never got.
We could do that.
Oh, we could do the Stampy and Squid made map.
Yeah, me and Squid made a Hunger Games map, which no one's ever seen.
Well, we've never
played
it. Yeah,
that might be a time for them to see it. Yeah. And so, I mean, what I'd really love is just sort of a world sharing option, you know, kind of like what they have in Halo. If anyone's played that, we have a file share where you can just basically upload a selection of maps. People just search by gamer tag and then can download them. That would be what would be amazing. I have spoke to 4J about that. I don't know what information I can say, but they basically said they explained why they haven't done that and why it would be difficult. They didn't say it would never happen, but it's something that they've thought about, but it doesn't seem like it's coming in the future. But that's what would be amazing.
Well, yeah, you know, but at least we're making progress. Like, I'm actually glad that this is happening, because I probably will get back into Hunger Games when this comes out and, you know, start recording on the Xbox game, which to be honest, I've kind of not really done. I've kind of, you know, kind of been mainly PC, but yeah, this is exciting. This is...
Yeah. I mean, I've moved away from kind of... I don't really do any mini game stuff anymore. So I'm kind of... Yeah, I mean, I'm definitely going to check it out. And I mean, I reckon I'll do like a video on each map. I reckon
yeah.
I'll do. I doubt I'm going to, you know, play it again and again and get really deep into strategy. You know, I check them all out. Because I really love 4J's maps. Like, you figure 4J is the developer. I love them as, I think they're really good map builders. So I'm kind of looking forward to just to seeing what maps they're able to create. You know, I don't know if you've seen much of the Mario mashup pack.
I saw the trailer and it looked ridiculously good. It looked amazing.
It's a full world. It literally fills in an entire world, like including
insane.
The Nether and everything.
That's insane.
It's crazy. So I mean, I know obviously they're not going to be that big, but if they're kind of to that quality and that level of detail, and from what I've seen, they do seem really good, and you know, generally have some game designers thinking about the balance of the map and stuff, which is something that occasionally is lacking from some of the, the community made maps. the thing is a lot of the community spend, I think, a lot more time making the map look really good.
Yeah.
And less time thinking of game design. I think the way it looks is often a priority, not always. And so I think that 4J, you know, might kind of come at it from the other angle. So yeah, I'm looking forward to that. Something else Minecraft related is, as we're recording this on Monday, it should have been announced on Tuesday, because this is going to be the first time I've been able to talk about this. But yeah, I'm going to be in Minecraft story mode as a character.
I saw that on Twitter. I DM'd them, but they didn't respond.
Did you DM? What did you DM them?
No, I didn't actually DM them. I just sent them a message because it was doing that thing on Twitter saying, "You're welcome to be a host at the da-da-da." And then I just sent them like a GIF of like me just walking along, kicking the sand.
Actually, I saw Sky Does Minecraft tweeted as well. Like, I think it's when they tweeted at Captain Sparkle saying like, "You've been invited to this event," and then he replied saying, "I think you spelt Sky wrong." And then that made me laugh. I can't talk about the actual story too much, obviously, because you know it's not out yet, you know, and you wouldn't want to hear that anyway. You probably want to play it, but yeah. So it's basically myself, Dan TDM, Stacey plays, LD Shadow Lady, and Captain Sparkles are kind of being guest characters for a kind of a one-off special episode. So it's still like a normal episode. We're still there with, you know, with Jesse and Lucas and Ivor and all of the old crowd, but then basically something happens to where they, you know, they're kind of in a situation where we're all together. And as a lot of people guess, there's kind of a bit of a mystery, murder mystery kind of vibe to it. Cluedo. As well. So yeah, we are kind of that kind of thing a little bit. And so there's, it was good. It was a good thing to be a part of. You know, we're not like kind of like becoming main characters now or anything. You know, it is very much, I mean, I'd say it's probably more than just a cameo appearance. You know, we have a decent amount of lines and stuff, but it's not like we're part of the gang now. Like, where are we off to next, Korea? You know, so it is kind of like a special episode. Who knows whether there'll be kind of anything else like this in the future. But yeah, it was good fun. And it's nice to announce it because, you know, I've been working on it for quite a long time, had quite a few different, you know, like voiceover sessions and stuff, and so I vlogged all of that as well, so I'll be sharing a lot of that. But it's nice just to finally let people know kind of what it is that I've been working on, and yeah, now I just need to wait to see whether it's any good or not, because yeah. The worst thing would be if it comes out and everyone just hates it and it's like, oh great, you know, I was part of that. Oh, yeah. So I've not seen anything, so I've not even seen the trailer as we're talking now, so I have literally no idea what they've done with our voices, and the way we record it is kind of all separately, so I literally had a script which I was given that morning with just a list of lines. So I was just basically kind of going through all my lines. So I don't, like, even though I'm in it, I don't even know the story overly well or exactly what happened. So it's going to be really weird playing through it and having me there, you know, as a character.
I think that's one of the, I think that's one of the worst things as well, as being a creator, when you do something and it's basically behind closed doors and you can't speak about it, but you kind of want to tell everybody. It's just that, you know, that waiting stage between, you know, you're so excited to say something but you can't. But yeah, should be good.
Yeah, I mean, one of the best things about being a YouTuber is generally that turnaround's pretty quick. Like, if you make a video, it's not like you're going to sit on it for a year before you do it. Like, I think games would be the worst thing, because, you know, some games will take, you know, 3, 4, 5 years to make. Imagine starting making a game 5 years ago and you can't tell anyone what you're working on, even like friends and family sometimes. You just can't tell anyone what you're working on.
Yeah.
Like, and you know, and it might be a really big, exciting thing. That must be the worst, because films are a lot more open. It's weird, because games are private. Don't tell anyone what we're doing. Oh no, the information leaked. They're all so quiet. Films are like, hey, we have an idea. We might make a script. I think we might have this actor. You know, they just kind of say everything kind of build up hype. But games are like, shh, no, don't tell anyone. We need to announce it at E3. Come on, everyone be quiet. You know, so it's weird how different they are.
I absolutely hate that though, because it was like the new Avengers movie. So, I mean, what they did was they pretty much just spoiled the entire, like, new character. Like, obviously, if you haven't seen it, okay, it's already in the trailer. Like, Spider-Man's in it, okay? But I was just thinking to myself, like, why would you not just wait until people see it and then surprise them with Spider-Man in it? Like, how much hype would have, like, created that from someone going and saying, ah, guess what? You know, Spider-Man's in it. Instead, they put it like 4 months before it came out. There was a trailer and it showed Spider-Man. I was like, why would you even do that? Like, why not have?
Because they think they're gonna sell more tickets. They can't. There's no, like, I never watch film trailers. I hate film trailers. They just show too much.
They give so much away. They pretty much show the whole film before you've even seen it. It's ridiculous.
Yeah, like, the only time I see a film trailer is if it's something I've literally never heard of, and I'm just like, is this going to be worth my time? But if it's like, if there's like a Pixar film or a Coen Brothers film or like, you know, a Quentin Tarantino film, or like if there's any kind of film that I have any trust in it at all, I won't see a trailer, because I don't want to know anything about it. Literally, because why? Like, it's just part of the experience is gone before you've even kind of arrived at that point. But, and also, it just means you've got to wait for ages. If they're like, hey, we've got an idea to work on this film, but then you have to wait like years until you see it. Like, I'd rather it say, hey, we've been working on this. It's almost done. It will be out next month. You know, then you're not waiting for it.
Yeah, yeah.
So that's kind of one of the things I hate. Like, why announce it early and then just have people wait? Because people just get...
They get hyped up, and then the hype dies down just when the film's about to come out. That's the problem.
Yeah. Yeah.
Overhyped, not good. So, yeah, that's how I feel. I'm the same as well, Stamps, actually. There's... I did something in January. I think it was the end of January, and the finished product still isn't out. So, I'm kind of the same right now with the whole sort of
and it's just
things.
The worst thing when you just literally can't, because you want to share, because, you know, so I think part of being a YouTuber is kind of being open and sharing everything and what you're getting on with and stuff. And so whenever someone's like, nope, you can't say anything, you're like, oh, but they're gonna want to know, and I want to tell them.
Yeah. so annoying. Anyway, we've blabbed on for like nearly an hour and we haven't done any sort of comments or any sort of tips yet.
No, I didn't even look at that. Gah. I just saw the time. Right, so I've been going through the Facebook page. So let me see what have we got here. This is topical. Well, it's topical as we're recording this. When everyone's listening, it won't be topical. And so I don't know how many people this is going to apply to. This might be a bad thing to talk about. But there's the relaunch of Top Gear. Just came out, didn't it? And so I know Top Gear is pretty international. I don't know how many of our audience watch Top Gear. It's basically a car show.
52 countries.
Yeah, it's one of the BBC's biggest shows. So it's basically a car show, and there were these three presenters, English presenters, that were much loved. They were very funny, had great chemistry, and they kind of made the show. Like, I don't care about cars, but I used to watch Top Gear. It was that kind of show.
Yeah, you were in it for
and
the
personality. And then, basically, long story short, those three presenters are gone. They're making a new car show, but then they relaunched Top Gear with Matt LeBlanc, aka Joey from Friends, and someone else called Chris Evans, who's kind of an old British presenter, also a radio DJ, and so they kind of relaunched it, and people have been pretty vocal about what they thought about it, so I was kind of interested to hear what you thought about it.
Yeah, I mean, I didn't watch it straight away when it came out. I kind of laid in bed this morning and went on BBC iPlayer and just watched half an hour of it and just kind of gauging what it was like, and I didn't like it. I did not like it. I can't stand Chris Evans, to be honest with you. I've never listened to any of his radio shows before. I will definitely not be listening to any in the future. And it just seemed... I don't know if you saw it or not, but throughout the whole thing, he was just kind of shouting. Like, he was dancing around the kind of show that had the set, and he was kind of, you know, swinging his hands about, and he just kept shouting. And I just felt so bad for, like, Matt LeBlanc, because all show, he was just shouting in his ear and at the audience. It was kind of cringeworthy. He's got kind of this voice where it's not really presenting it. It's more like an old English teacher that kind of whines a lot.
He's like, it's kind of what we spoke about at the beginning of this podcast. It doesn't sound like he's having a chat. It sounds like he's hosting. It sounds like he would come out saying, hi, I'm Chris Evans, and this is Mad LeBlanc. You know, it sounds like he's
the
doing...
the warm-up guy.
...doing that. Like he's, you know, like he's... you know, like in theater or something, I guess, rather than, you know, chatting with your mates about cars, which was kind of the feeling that the old presenters gave.
It was, I mean, I kind of saw, I don't know if you, did you see it?
Yeah, I did the same as you. I watched it this morning on iPlayer.
I don't know. I mean, I didn't really give Matt that much of a chance. I mean, I don't think he's like a bad guy or anything like that. I mean, I've liked Friends and everything like that, and I'm sure that he's going to come out of his shell later on in the series, because Chris kind of, he was trying to fill in Jeremy's shoes, and he kind of did it too much, if you know what I mean. He tried to be like Jeremy instead of trying to be himself, but I don't know. I just don't think he's the right guy. Someone actually tweeted me and said that there was like a Top Gear extra, and there was another presenter on there, and he was with Matt LeBlanc, and they worked out a lot better together, and apparently he's got a much nicer voice, so they were saying, you know, maybe he should try and take over the role. But yeah, I think they were down like 2 million views compared to what it was normally with the old presenters, so, you know.
But you can't blame the show for that, because people hadn't seen it yet, you know, like, so, I mean, the thing is, I didn't want to talk about Top Gear too much, because I know that you know, there's a lot of people listening this to where, you know, just won't, you know, they might not have not heard of it, or it just won't be relevant. So, but I think it just raises an interesting point of kind of where something is so loved and then they try and change it. Like everyone, even before they announced who the hosts were going to be, everyone was set to not like it.
Yeah.
So no matter what, they had their odds against them. And then I think they made a huge mistake because they basically took the exact same format of the show, but then put new hosts in. Like this was kind of their opportunity to start fresh and make their own thing, but they didn't. They tried to keep it exactly the same, but have new hosts. And so people, it makes it really easy to compare it to the way it was. So yeah. I think it was people were destined to not like it. Because, I mean, I think even if they did then change a bunch, people would say, oh, well, it's not Top Gear anymore. I don't like it. So I think that no matter what, this was going to fail. And I think that Matt LeBlanc was actually really good because it's such, the show's so much about kind of British humor and there's lots of like, you know, there's lots of making fun of Americans and stuff in it, you know, always kind of jokingly, but that's kind of a bit of a running joke, you know. So it's kind of, when I saw, oh, they've got, you know, kind of this famous American actor in it, I was like, oh, how's that going to work? But he was good. He was funny. He was yeah, witty, you know, and he seemed quite natural. And he's not a presenter. He's an actor. So, you know, the odds were against him. So you'd expect Chris Evans to be better.
I think that
Chris, they were trying to make it too like a big thing. I think Chris Evans wanted it to be like this big thing, so he was trying to big it up too much, and that ended up kind of ruining it.
Yeah, pretty much. I think someone like Anton Deck would have been better, to be honest with you, or just someone that hated cars. I think it would have been amazing. Like just some people that hate driving, hate cars.
I think we should have done it. We'd have the mixture. You like cars. I don't care too much. We would have been. We should present Top Gear.
But there isn't actually a YouTuber that's in the show. He was a car guy.
Yeah.
He was actually... Well, you know, they've got like a million presenters. One of them is a YouTuber whose channel is dedicated to cars. He actually got the job. And it was so funny because there was a picture of them all lined up and it had like a little caption next to them. So there was basically saying like, oh, Stig was the one that basically couldn't get, you know, over to the new series or didn't want to leave. Then there's the annoying ginger guy and then there's the guy from Friends. And then it went over to the YouTube and there was just like... It was just like a blank statement saying, I don't know who this is. It was pretty funny. But yeah, I don't really know what they're going to do because I guess they've kind of got the whole season already filmed. So we'll see. I'm looking forward to the show on Top Gear, though. Not sure, Top Gear, the show on Amazon. I want to see how that goes. I think that'll be pretty awesome when it comes out.
I'm worried that they're going to do the same thing. I'm worried that they're not going to change enough. Like, I feel like this is kind of...
They don't need to change. Why do they need to change?
I just feel like, because they got a chance to make a new show here, and I think that they got their personalities and they were, you know, they've been working together for so long. I know, but I don't want it to seem like they're making a new version of Top Gear. I want them to make, you know, to start from, think about, you know, a chance to think about, right, what works best, you know, rather than saying, right, what have we done? Just to say, basically, as if they're starting again, what would be a good idea? You know, rather than thinking, oh, well, we need our replacement for our interview with a celebrity. Oh, we need our replacement of the Top Gear track. You know, I don't want them to
studio. I think all of it is out, you know, out and about doing stuff.
Out and about.
Doing go this, to the shop, feeding
out
the
and
ducks.
About. All around. Here we go. Anyway, sorry. That's enough Top Gear talk. I just felt like it. I wasn't going to bring it up, but I seen that someone commented about it. So I was like, oh, at least some percent of people listening to this, you know, might know what it is.
Well,
and
I tweeted about
so,
it. And, and I don't think anyone said to me, like, what is it? I think everyone pretty much knows what it is. Some girl was like, yeah, my dad made me sit and watch it. Which is pretty funny. Go on then. Anyway,
so there's another comment I got. This is from Dave also Sky, and they commented, and so this is about one of the Let's Talk. I did a Let's Talk recently about trends and about how there's kind of these trends that kind of keep coming and going. So I talked a little bit about YouTube. I was just talking about like dancers and sayings. Like the example I used is YOLO, you know, as a kind of thing that kind of came and went. And at the moment, everyone keeps saying banter and stuff. You know, like, I kind of talk about these trends. And in that, I talk about how there's kind of video game trends for YouTubers where there'll be a trendy game and it will come out and everyone will do it, you know, for about a month and no one will do it. And I kind of gave the example of like that YouTuber's life game that kind of everyone has, you know, is doing videos on. And, you know, next week, no one will be doing videos on as kind of like as a trend. And so I kind of said that how there's a, when a game comes out and everyone does videos on it, it kind of makes a lot of other people want to do videos on it.
Yeah.
But it kind of puts me off doing a video on it.
Yeah.
So anyway, that's kind of what I said about in the Let's Talk to bring everyone up to speed. But he says, Stampy, this is the question about your Let's Talk on trends. When Minecraft Story Mode came out, you played it, even though lots of other people played it. Don't you think that's a bit hypocritical?
Oh, which I think is, I guess, I called you out.
But the thing is, so I think the difference is that, like, I wasn't playing it because a lot of other people were playing. You know, I had, you know, I had decided to, you know, I got it sent early. Like, I had recorded the videos before it even came out, before it was, I guess, a trend. And so, I guess I'm not saying you shouldn't do something if other people are doing it, but you shouldn't do it just because other people are doing it. And I'm not even saying that because, you know, do what you want, whatever. Like, who am I to say what you can and can't do? I'm just saying, like, I guess, yeah, I guess just to kind of explain myself from that, yeah, like, I wasn't doing story mode just because I saw a lot of other people doing it. It's because I'm a Minecraft YouTuber, and it was basically a new Minecraft game came out. Of course I was going to do it. Like, how could I not do it? The kind of the example I'm saying about is, say, if there's a new film coming out and then you purposely do a game of Hunger Games on a map themed around it because you know people are searching for it, or, you know, like, when that's kind of the thing that I was more talking about there. But yeah, good point, Dave, also Sky.
Well, I want to just say I kind of stopped the trend because I didn't enjoy it, so yeah.
Oh, did you play it?
Well, I kind of, well, I did the first five, which was the, you know, the pretty much the first story for the Minecraft story, you know, with the wither and everything like that. And then I kind of...
Oh, sorry, I thought you were talking about YouTuber's life here, that
no,
game.
No, I'm talking about Minecraft Story Mode.
Yeah.
So I kind of did the first story. I played that all through, recorded it, uploaded it. Everyone kind of, you know, enjoyed it. And then the next one came out, and I sat down and I recorded it, and I just didn't upload it. I just didn't want to start another full series because I just didn't enjoy it, to be honest. Like,
so which episode? What was the last one you played through?
I honestly can't remember. It was the end of the last. Obviously, you know, when they defeat the Wither Storm and everything like that.
And then, so you finished that story?
Yeah, I finished that. But then I kind of didn't pick up the next story. I didn't really enjoy it, so I just didn't start it. I didn't want to start the first kind of episode and then think, oh, I'm not going to enjoy it. So I just didn't. I didn't want to kind of, you know, dive into it again. I'm kind of happy with the first sort of experience, and you know, I enjoyed it while it was, you know, about. But I just didn't really want to do it again because even though I recorded and uploaded the first bunch, I just kind of felt like it was repetitive then. But I still kind of wanted to finish it. So,
yeah, because I mean, it gets to a point where you want to, even if you're not enjoying it, you kind of want to let everyone else kind of finish the story.
Yeah.
You know, because the stories are so unique, you kind of want to follow that through. But it's kind of weird because I've been enjoying story mode. Like, I have problems with it. You know, and I'm always very open about that in the episode when there's bits that, you know, there's very specific moments that annoy me. And then there was kind of just the whole tone of it.
Yeah.
Kind of, I just felt was, you know, it felt too much, like a lot like other Telltale games. They were kind of very dark, and I felt like it kind of didn't fit the Minecraft, you know, amazingly. But the last episode they released, I think it's episode 5 or 4. Yeah, 4. Episode 4, I think it is. Maybe. I can't remember. The one where you defeat the Wither. No, the one after that. The one
five.
After you defeat
five.
The Wither. Yeah. Where it kind of started the story again. That was my favorite one of them all.
Okay.
Because that one, there wasn't a big horrible thing looming over one's head. Everyone wasn't worried because, oh, they're all gonna die from this big dangerous thing. It was a more lighthearted adventure where they were like, they were essentially adventuring for the fun of adventuring,
yeah,
rather than, oh no, we need to survive. And I just think it was just much more lighthearted. I think it was just funnier. I think the comedy, you know, was just better in it.
Yeah.
And so I kind of was like, ah, this is kind of more what I hoped for from the very beginning. And so I kind of, that was my kind of my favorite one, I think, so far, and that kind of gave me more hope for the future ones. But it's kind of weird that that's kind of the one that turned you off most.
Well, no, I mean it wasn't that in general. I think it was just with the one, like you said, the 1 to 4 kind of it kind of put me off, to be honest, because, as you say, it was kind of dark. All the humor was kind of forced, and it wasn't really, you know, that funny, and there wasn't much input you could do as a player. You know, it wasn't much different from you playing it to when I was playing it. So, Yeah, I don't know. I just kind of put it down. I did the series, and I kind of put it down. I thought, you know, I've done it. I've had a go at it. It's kind of finished, but I'll let other people, let other YouTubers pick it up and play the rest. So, yeah.
You take it from here, lads. I've done my bit.
But yeah, when you said about YouTubers' life, I think what... Because I kind of like the idea, but then I saw everybody jump on it. So I think what I might do is release it on the second channel, but maybe play it for 3 hours... And then get my editor to kind of.
But so why are you deciding to play it though? I guess that's kind of the point. Like what? Why?
Just looked fun. Like not because everyone like I looked at it from the start, and then obviously I saw everyone else playing it, and there wasn't, you know, it wasn't like, oh, it was good for, you know, it seemed to go down well with the audience, or, you know, I thought it might get decent views. There wasn't anything to do with that. It was just kind of like, you know, it looked fun. It looked like a sort of cross between the Tube Tycoon. Which I had a go at, which was pretty fun. But it looked more Sims-like, and it was a lot more in-depth. Like, you could edit videos and you know, obviously all the different settings with upgrading your PC and moving out and stuff like that. It just looked kind of like a fun sort of experience. So I just kind of wanted to...
I just think it looks really bad. Like, I just don't... I don't know. Maybe I just don't get that game. No, I haven't. Well, but I mean, okay. I've seen a few videos on it. And so I just feel like if someone saw a trailer for that game, they wouldn't think, oh, I've got to record it.
You know, no.
So many different YouTubers wouldn't see a trailer and think, because it's like, it doesn't look bad enough to be funny bad, because that's what a lot of people do games for that.
Yeah.
And it doesn't seem good. I think it's just because it's themed around YouTubers, and then just enough of the first big YouTubers did it. It kind of just trickled down.
Yeah.
You know, like Five Nights at Freddy's, you know, like that turned huge, you know, and everyone loved it. But, you know, it's just because one or two big YouTubers did it. And so then everyone else started doing videos on it. And then because everyone was doing videos about it, people started buying it. And so then there was a demand for it. Like it's, you know, and that was kind of that the trend of that time, you know. But I just look at just what the game is, and I just feel like it doesn't seem that special or unique. Or why are so many people doing videos on specifically this thing?
Yeah, well, I mean, it's not really going to be sort of like a let's play on it as such. It's going to be more of like, okay, this is new out, I'm going to play it because, you know, A, it looks half decent, and it's good content for the second channel. But it's more of like a summary video. Like, instead of doing it like, you know, is it going to be, you know, worth a let's play, it's kind of playing it and making like my sort of opinion on it, if that makes sense.
So you're kind of like reviewing it as you play.
Yeah, reviewing it, sort of. That's reviewing it, Stamps. There we go, you took the word right out of my mouth.
But then at that point, it's like, we might as well play through the entire game and then come up with a proper summary. You know, if you're reviewing it, you kind of might as well complete the game, you know, see everything that it has to offer, and then, so, you know, rather than let's play it.
Yeah. Possibly. We'll see.
I don't know. It just seems like, it seems because of the amount of, you think of all the games that have been released in, you know, just the last week or whatever. Well, you know, what's the, are you reviewing that game because... because of the popularity of it?
No. I'm just reviewing it because I want to. I want to play it. So I might as well record it. I want to see what it's like. That's the only reason behind it.
Yeah.
Like, it's not anything to do with, you know, how popular it is. It's just something that's caught my eye and I want to see what it's all about, to be honest with you. And I might as well record it. It's, you know, it's stuff to go out and, yeah.
So. It's just interesting how, like, something's popularity, like, feeds it more popularity. Like, when something gets slightly popular, like, that slight popularity is what makes it become more popular. It literally does, like, snowball, doesn't it? Like,
yeah.
Because, a game, you know, whatever game it is, gets slightly popular, you know, that means more people, you know, will do videos on it, and then it gets more and more, and it kind of just keeps snowballing more and more and more. Like, you just need that kind of that first spark to set it off.
Well, I mean, that's why companies, like, you know, I don't know if kids on those or not, but sometimes companies will approach, like, me and Stamps, and they'll say, hey, you know, we got this new game out, you know, no one really knows about it, but, you know, we might, you know, give you... you know, a little bit of money if you will play this game and promote it. I mean, that's what a lot of companies do nowadays. You know, the game might not be that successful without a big YouTuber doing like one video on it or whatever. So, like you said, it's all about whether the company wants to push it or not.
People are really starting to see the value, I guess, in that now. And I don't know if there has been... It's hard to know when those deals are made. So I don't know if there has been any big success where a game has been kind of advertised in that way, and because of that, it ended up blowing up. Because I don't know. Every game that has blown up on YouTube, it kind of seems like it might not be a game you'd expect. I look at like Stardew Valley or something. I think that a lot of people wouldn't look at that, you know, kind of, you know, kind of relatively simple farming. Actually, I don't want to call it simple because it's not simple. You know, I think people would look at kind of this that farming simulator game made by almost one person and say they might not guess that that's the thing that would blow up and become absolutely huge. You know, it's kind of, it's just such a hard thing. It's the same with like esport games. You know, it's very hard to predict which game people are going to play in tournaments or not. And there's a lot of games that when they're announcing it, they say, yeah, it'd be great for esports. We can have all of these tournaments. And, you know, if it's not popular, then just no one's going to watch the tournaments. And so people won't have tournaments. You know, they just can't.
Do you remember,
it's just
Stout,
a very hard thing to announce.
Do you remember when me and you got asked to do esports on Minecraft?
Yeah, kind of. there were conversations about that.
Oh, dear. That was good. That was going to be funny. That was going to be pretty good. But anyway, we haven't done a squiddy tip, Stamps. It's like nearly time for switching off.
Well, should we do back-to-back tips then? Should we do
back-to-back tips,
a Stampy and a squiddy tip?
Let's go.
Back-to-back.
Okay.
So squiddy tips. Right. I'll just make one up. In a minute. Let me just think of one. Okay. So your squiddy tip is... What is the most successful way to climb a tree when you are covered in slippery butter?
I love your thought process. Like right now, for people who are watching the video podcast, Stamps is just staring at a tree. So I'm guessing that's kind of where.
I'm going to take my inspiration from somewhere, don't I?
He's looking around the room. Right, Stamps. So the best way to climb a tree... Actually, I'll read it out as you did. Okay. The best way to climb... okay, the best way to climb a tree while being buttery is... It's going to be a short and simple one because we're running out of time. So the best way to do it, Stamps, is that you want to roll around in some... I'm answering it the way you were saying it now. You want to find yourself a beehive.
Thinking and speaking. It's not as easy as it looks.
You find yourself a beehive. Okay. Then what you want to do is you want to grab the beehive and smash it on the floor so all the honey gets trickled out everywhere. And then with your slippery body, you then want to roll yourself into the honey to create a sticky sort of cocoon around yourself. Then while you're on the floor... You roll up to the tree and you carry on rolling and you will basically stick to the back and that's how you climb trees.
Brilliant. Thanks, Squid.
Welcome.
Very useful tip that everyone will apply in their day-to-day life.
saving a life every day with
squid. I need
tips.
To get up that tree, but I'm far too covered in butter to do it. Who will give me advice?
Listen to the
right,
podcast.
Okay, well, you need to come up with a Stampy tip now, so it's your turn to
speak. I don't have the Facebook page. Has anyone got any, like, serious one?
No, I came up with a squiddy tip for you. You can come up with a Stampy tip. Come on. Your turn to speak and think.
But yours is serious, isn't it?
It doesn't mean it'd be whatever. It'd be whatever you want.
Okay, what's the best way to deal with annoying customer support?
Well, don't go back there. Don't support them.
Don't go back there.
vote with your wallet. So if the thing is, okay, so a lot of people can get really fed up with this stuff. So you immediately said, did I complain? You know, and I didn't complain because I don't care enough to complain. Like I was like, that moment was rubbish. They were bad, but I just don't care if they get punished or whatever. You know, I'm just not bothered by it. So I think just kind of... Just take it as, right, okay, they're kind of rubbish people. You know, they're bad at their job.
They're,
you know, they shouldn't
people.
Be working where they are. They were rubbish people.
They're
they were bad
humans.
At being... They were bad at being... Forgetting the fact that they were supposed to be working. They were just rude people, you know, in general, whatever. They couldn't have cared less about what they were doing.
Yeah.
You know, and so, you know, they were rubbish, but I just didn't care that much. You know, I'm not going to go and start huffing and puffing and, oh, ruin my day and I'm not going back, you know, whatever. Like, just don't worry about it. Whatever. Move on. Like, just don't... It's not worth wasting more time of your own life thinking and worrying about it and trying to deal with it than it is just to move on and just do something else and have fun, you know? At the end of the day, we got ice cream. We got to see some animals. We had a good day, you know, and I didn't let that moment, you know, be the thing that ruined it, I guess. So it's probably... I don't know if this is good advice. It's very British advice, just kind of ignore it and move on, whatever, but that's kind of what I do, and I'm happy.
So there you go, another successful... Oh, and the Stamps, I know what we've forgotten to do.
What's that?
We completely forgot about the origami.
Oh, no. Well, I even... So, people, you guys listening, you're incredible. You know that. Those people that sold ice cream at the zoo, they were rubbish people. You all listening, you are incredible people, especially you, because you listen right to the end. Yeah. So have you seen the Facebook page and Twitter and stuff?
No, people have been going
origami crazy.
Have they?
They've been doing amazingly. And so there have been people who have been doing like Stampy and Squid ones. Some people. And I think they were showing off a little bit. But they did it so good. They did like proper 3D ones where they kind of like curled the paper and made a proper swan shape. People did amazing at the origami. So how well did you do, Squid?
Yeah, great. 4D. Did 4D ones. Yeah, there's the swan actually... was alive. Did amazing.
Yeah? Yeah. And flew away, so you got no pictures.
Exactly. No, it ate itself. It ate its paper.
Did you not do it, Squid?
I was away. I couldn't do anything.
Squid, that's outrageous. You could have done it when you were away. That's a perfect holiday activity. Everyone sit round as a family and make origami swan. Squid, I'm absolutely outraged.
Sorry,
you.
Mate.
I can't
Did
believe
you make
this.
One?
This is ridiculous. No, I forgot.
Oh, so who's there? Who's just as bad then?
Well, I didn't think Mr. I
pointing
I remembered.
Finger over here.
Yeah, no, I was doing it. I was setting up for that joke.
Wait, so we need to do something else.
No. We are gonna do something else, but we're not gonna neglect the thing because we told everyone else to do an origami swan, and I can't tell everyone else to do it and not do one myself. So we will do one. I kept thinking to do it, and I was like, oh, I'll do it later. But I will do it. We will both do an origami swan this week, and we'll share it on the Facebook page for us all to see. I'm sorry we both did rubbish this week. Squid's got a better excuse than I do. I'm just rubbish, but we will do it. So what's this week's homework?
Oh, I don't really know. What can beat the origami swan?
Well, we spoke about chess a bit. We could try and challenge everyone to learn chess.
Can we do like a customer service sort of scenario? So kind of like how we do ice cream parlor. Can we get two people to like record a video of themselves? Like, you know, one person being the customer, one person being like a really bad employee. And then like... They both turn around and like have like a training video, like, okay, what to do here is to ignore the rude employee, something like that. Can we do something like, you know, like a training video? I think that'd be funny.
Well, you want... So your homework is for everyone to record a customer service training video.
Yeah.
Right, you heard it, everyone. Good luck with that. Send us it on the Facebook page, Twitter, YouTube, however you can send it to us. We'd love to see your customer service training videos. That would be pretty entertaining. Me and Squid can have a go doing one together in the podcast next week. But sadly, we've run out of time this week.
Yeah, so that's it for us. The podcast will be online next Sunday at around about the afternoon, around about 12:30 or maybe later. We don't even know, but yeah. Thanks for watching, guys. We'll see you in the next one. Goodbye.
Bye. Bye.